So really fabulous turnout for our special guests. So very thrilled to have you for the, it's our second event for the Triangle Center on Terrorism and Homeland Security. We had Secretary of Homeland Security, Jay Johnson, earlier in the year. I will give you a preview. We're having the special Inspector General for Afghanistan Affairs, John Sopko, will be here on March 24th, and that will be our concluding event of the year. But my name's David Schanzer. I recognize many of you, students, former students, colleagues, community members who come to these events and our AGS, American Grand Strategy events. So we are thrilled to have you tonight. But we're especially privileged to have our guests from the Southern Poverty Law Center, an organization I'm sure many of you have been following and maybe supporting for many decades, and others are just learning about the very, very important work that they do. So we have Richard Cohen here, the president of the organization, and Heidi Beirich, who is the head of their intelligence project, and they're both going to speak with you, dialogue, answer some of my questions, and there'll be time for questions from the audience as well. But why don't we first welcome them to Duke University. Richard, I know you wanted to say a few words and kind of open up our event this evening, so the floor is yours.
Thank you, David. First, thank all of you for coming out tonight. It really means a lot to us to be here. I want to thank David in particular for inviting us. I've testified in Congress four times in the last 2 years on issues relating to terrorism, and each time I have found the work that David has done through the Triangle Center on Terrorism and Homeland Security invaluable. I've quoted it extensively, and it was one of the reasons I wanted to come here, because just to trade some ideas. So thank you, David, for that work.
Thank you so much.
Before I get too far, I just wanted to ask if there are any supporters of the Southern Poverty Law Center here tonight. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you for making our work possible. I know, I don't know if some of you, we had an event yesterday in Chapel Hill. I don't know if many of you maybe didn't get to there and came here tonight. So I appreciate that. I'm also glad that my colleague Heidi Beirich, you know, has joined me, because, you know, Heidi is I have a doctorate, but it's called a JD. It doesn't really count. And Heidi has a PhD, which I think, you know, has more status in a place like this than my degree. So, you know, just a couple things I'd like to start with. First, just for those of you who don't know, the Southern Poverty Law Center started in 1971. It's a very small organization, really dedicated to making the promise of the recently enacted Civil Rights Acts a reality in the Deep South. And we fought many battles against the likes of George Wallace, for things like voting rights, for opening, you know, the corridors of state power to people who had long been disenfranchised. We quickly branched out to many, many other areas, gender discrimination, the rights of children, the rights of those with mental disabilities, really the gamut of things. Then in 1979, 1980, in response to a rise in hate groups in our country, happened during the days of double-digit inflation under the Carter administration, saw a tremendous increase in the number of, like, Klan groups, for example. And so we started a division that tracks these groups, and we've brought a number of, exposed their activities, brought lawsuits for the violent actions of their members. And that's really what my colleague Heidi Beirich is in charge of, and it's such an important part of our work. Lastly, you know, we have an education program. It goes under the name Teaching Tolerance, provide free classroom materials to every school in the country. We publish a magazine by that name twice a year. And we send at least two issues of the magazine to every school in the country. There are some schools that send them back, I'm afraid. And we also make documentary films that we send free of charge to any school that requests them. Four of our films have been nominated for Academy Awards. Two have won Oscars, and we're very proud of that work. So thank you. Thank you. I want to talk just briefly, if I could, about some things that we see, some things that are concerning to us. You know, terrorism is in the news all the time nowadays, and the fear of terrorism is, you know, really quite great. And there's no doubt that, you know, 9/11 was the Pearl Harbor of our time. You know, it's a tragedy that created or led to the creation of the Department of Homeland Security. We would never want to minimize that threat. At the same time, we wouldn't want to ignore other threats to the homeland. And those are the kinds of threats that Heidi and her team are expert at tracking and keeping tabs on. And, you know, the threat of those groups or the prevalence of those groups has increased tremendously over the past 20 years. In 1999, there were about 467 hate groups in our country. Today, there are about 917, almost double the number that there were in 1999. And Heidi is going to, you know, talk a lot about that. And the level of violence has increased tremendously from these groups from the 90s to the more recent decades. So, you know, I think it's a very, very serious problem that can't be ignored. You know, sometimes, you know, I remember Peter Bergen had that center on terrorism often on television, and he would say things like, since 9/11, there have been more people killed by, you know, kind of domestic terrorists of the white supremacist kind than by jihadis. I always thought it was a stupid thing to say, to be quite frank with you, because, you know, if you started counting the day before 9/11, then the day after 9/11, you'd get a totally, totally different count. So I thought it was a silly thing to say. I think the important thing to say is, you know, we can't ignore either. And unfortunately, our country has sometimes taken its eye off the ball, if I could talk a little bit about that. You know, the most significant act of domestic terrorism prior to 9/11 was the 1995 Oklahoma City bombing, killing, I couldn't remember if it was 94 or 95, one or the other, you know, killing 168 men, women, and children. And of course, it was carried out by someone who had 1 foot in the anti-government militia movement and 1 foot in the white supremacist movement. Tim McVeigh, who patterned his bombing after something called the Turner Diaries, which was a white supremacist, you know, novel that began with the bombing of a federal building at 9 o'clock in the morning with a 5,000-pound, you know, ammonium nitrate and fertilizer bomb. Interestingly, when it happened, you know, we didn't know, but we suspected, you know, it wasn't a coincidence that it was 9 in the morning, a federal building, and a big fertilizer bomb. But people on television were immediately talking about Islamic terrorism because there was some kind of center in Oklahoma. I don't remember the details, but we thought, well, that seemed unlikely, and, you know, we turned out to be right. And after that, Attorney General Reno set up a task force within the Justice Department to clamp down on this kind of stuff. And there was a big increase in these prevalence of anti-government groups, hate groups, and I think the Justice Department did a really fine job in that regard. That task force, because it was such a high priority, met once a month. And quite coincidentally, it was scheduled to meet on 9/11. Of course, you know, it didn't meet for obvious reasons during that time, you know, on that day. Unfortunately, it never met again until 2014. You know, the pendulum in terms of keeping track of, you know, terrorism just, you know, swung entirely, you know, kind of in the direction of, you know, going after radical or perverse forms of, you know, terrorism motivated by perverse or radical forms of Islam. And really this failure was, you know, kind of a bipartisan affair. It was as much, I would say, you know, President Obama's fault as it was President Bush's fault. During, in 2009, there was a report that came out from the Department of Homeland Security that started talking about the threat of kind of radical right terrorism in light of the fact that we had just elected the first African-American president. It was, you know, it was a reasonable thing to be thinking about, right? And there's a lot of kind of like a expected backlash to it. There was such such a response, or such an angry response to the report from certain conservative elements. You know, the certain members of Congress thought they were painting like all military veterans as potential terrorists, or all, you know, anti-abortion focused potential terrorists. It wasn't true, but there was that tremendous, you know, furious response. And Secretary Napolitano, I think quite shamelessly, claimed that the report had never been authorized in the first place and withdrew it. I know for a fact that that was not true. In 2010, I was appointed, it was surely a mistake, I was appointed to the Secretary's Advisory Committee, you know, on like terrorism. And, you know, we met by phone a number of times. And like a lot of federal advisory committees, sometimes they're just for show. I hate to say that about that, but they are sometimes just for show. So I'm on the phone with these people. Governor O'Malley from Maryland is chairing it. And they're talking, then talking. And I said, well, what about this, that, and the other? I kept on trying to raise the issue. They even let me bring in a member of Heidi's staff as a subject matter expert to talk to them about it. In the end, they totally ignored it. There was not one word in the report that they issued about kind of radical right terrorism. And it, you know, it continued. In 2015, President Obama had a, you know, in the Department of Homeland Security had a big, you know, event in Washington on terrorism, Homeland Security, and whatnot. The first terrorist event that President Obama talked about in his remarks, in his speech, was Oklahoma City. It was never mentioned again after that. I mean, the right, you know, radical right terror was never mentioned one time in the conference after that. It was all, you know, kind of radical Islamic terrorism. In 2015, 2 weeks after the Charleston massacre, the House Committee on Homeland Security issued a terrorism alert listing, you know, recent terrorist events. For a reason best known only to them, they did not list the Charleston shootings as an act of terror. Really quite incredible. What it took, you know, the Department of Justice finally kind of reconstituted that committee or that task force only in 2014, when a well-known white supremacist, someone who we had once sued in court in North Carolina and put in jail, killed three people that he thought were Jewish in Overton Park, Kansas. It took that event for the government suddenly, you know, to, it's like a wake-up call, right? And, you know, to start, you know, pushing more resources kind of in that direction. You know, we don't know what will happen, you know, under the current administration. You know, some early indications are that the focus will return, you know, exclusively to, you know, so-called, you know, radical Islamic terrorism. We don't know. The last thing I would say, if I could, is that some of the, and I owe this to David and I've testified about it in Congress, you know, twice. Some of our focus, it seems, domestically, on so-called Islamic terrorism, you know, it has the potential to backfire, right? We have these programs countering violent extremism. And, you know, it sounds like, you know, we're going to focus on all forms of extremism, but the reality is that those programs have not. And so in the, you know, Muslim community in this country, there's a perception, one based on fact, that these programs are entirely one-sided. There's also a perception, one based on fact, that the government is sending informants into mosques, things like that. And of course, you know, if you're trying to integrate kind of a religious minority into kind of the mainstream of American life, to cast suspicions on them in that way, to single them out in that way, you know, has the potential of playing into a narrative that they're hearing from foreign recruiters. And, you know, and I think one of the things that I think David and his colleagues in a recent report were very, you know, brave to say, and was speaking truth to power, was that some of the rhetoric in the political campaign had the potential, again, to play into the terrorist hands by having, you know, letting them say, you see, we are at a war with Islam. The government doesn't trust you, that kind of stuff. So I guess the couple takeaways, again, the problems of radical right terrorism are real and significant. The government has often kind of completely ignored them. And in fact, sometimes our policies have been, you know, kind of quite counterproductive. David said I had 90 seconds to say all that. By my watch, that's all it took.
I didn't say that. And Richard accurately described some of our research. I mean, I do want to say that I support the concept, and some people don't. I support the concept of governmental efforts to counter violent extremism in a prevention sense. But I've said from the beginning, I just didn't think that they had a chance of working unless they were even-handed. Unless, if we're going to have a governmental program that's trying to deal with politicized violence, that if we don't try to address all different forms of that violence, then, as you said, if it's only focused on one form, then those people are going to be very suspicious of those programs, and therefore they're less likely to work. Well, Heidi, let me turn to you. One of the big projects of Southern Poverty Law Center is this annual census of hate groups. And before we dive into the details of this year's report, could you tell us what does that term to you mean? What is a hate group?
Sure. So we have been tracking hate groups for, I don't know, 25 years or so. We have a definition that we use to look at these organizations. And it relies on the official statements or ideology of the group. So I want to make that clear first. It's not, are they violent or not? Not that a lot of these groups aren't violent, but that's not the thing that we're looking at. And what we want to know is, does the organization treat an entire group of people based on their sort of immutable inherent characteristics as lesser? So this is an easy thing to understand when you think about neo-Nazis thinking Jews, you know, are an evil parasitic class that are destroying our country and need to be killed, right, and removed. But it also applies to groups, for example, that consider the LGBT community to be one that deserves to be defamed. You know, all gay men are pedophiles, for example. All trans people are trying to rape you in a bathroom. Whatever that propaganda might be, we are looking at that. You know, probably 2/3 of the groups on the list are things that you would consider white supremacist. But we also list some black groups as hate groups. And then we have, you know, a huge anti-Muslim section, for example. There's, you know, various kinds of categories. But the big question for us at the end of the day is, do they treat this group of people, and I mean all of them, as lesser human beings? That's what we're looking for.
So let me just push you a little bit on this. Your critics say, and people in the room won't be surprised to know that there are critics of Southern Poverty Law Center.
I did not know that.
They would argue, well, you are just putting essentially a pejorative label on organizations whose politics and policies you don't like, whether it be groups who are advocating for lower immigration or groups who are advocating against gay rights or on any of these different issues, against affirmative action. And you use this term to weaken them or taint them in the public eye by calling them hate groups. So what is your response to that claim from your critics?
Yeah, I mean, in most cases, I just simply disagree with what they're trying to say. For example, we're attacked in multiple ways. So you did point that out there. And the groups that we list as anti-LGBT groups usually say that we list them because they believe that homosexuality is a biblical sin, or because they're against gay marriage. That is not true. We are listing them specifically because they defame the entire LGBT community, and in really, really ugly ways. And what they're doing is very much akin to the way Jews were treated by Hitler in his propaganda efforts. In other words, the whole class is made to seem scary, sexually deviant, coming after you. That's what we're looking
disease.
At. Disease is actually one of the predominant things that all of these organizations use to harm, to defame the groups that they're against. The immigration situation is the same. We don't list groups because they say, for example, I'm concerned that hospitals are overwhelmed or classrooms are dealing with immigration levels that are higher. Those aren't the reasons that people get on our list as an anti-immigrant hate group. You have to literally be driven by white nationalist impulses in your policy. So, for example, the Federation for American Immigration Reform, which is one of the groups that we list that has some serious political standing, right? That is an organization that has said, for example, that the 1965 Immigration Act was set up to take Anglo-Saxons out of power. In other words, they view it as a race issue. Their leader has talked about how, people coming from Latin America are more criminal, lower IQs, less able to function in Western civilization. I could go on and on and on. These are race-based arguments. So that's what we're looking at. If we listed every group that didn't like immigration at the levels it was today, our list would be a million times long. And the same would go in terms of the anti-LGBT groups, right? Because a lot of Christian churches and others, not just Christian, in the U.S. are against homosexuality because of the way they read the Bible. So, I mean, that's my response to those criticisms. And what I don't like about those criticisms is when they're not challenged, then we're not talking about the same issues, which is really ugly defamation of populations that, frankly, at the end of the day, make them open to hate crimes with people that agree with these ideas. And that's the end result of that kind of hate speech.
Can I add one thing Please. To that? Our listing of the Family Research Council, what we would call an anti-gay hate group, has probably been among our most controversial. And their leaders.
This is kind of what they would say as a conservative group in Colorado that.
No, this is in Washington.
Oh, okay.
You're talking about Focus on the Family.
Okay, right.
Focus on the Family is not a group that we would list as a hate group. They're extremely conservative when it comes to LGBT issues, but it's a good example of the fact that we don't paint with that kind of brush. Now, the Family Research Council knows that we don't list them just because they oppose gay marriage. They know that. Because they can read our material, yet they persist in saying that because they think there's a political advantage to them to misportray or what it is and misinterpret what we're saying about them. That's a tactic that they're using. I would add something about the groups, some of the anti-immigrant groups that we list. And Heidi, help me here. I think the leader of one of them, not FAIR, but maybe it's the Center for Immigration Studies, recently said that one of the problems with Haiti, one of the reasons it had so many problems, was that it hadn't been colonized long enough. And that seems like an incredibly racist thing to say. The leader, the person who originally founded the Federation of American Immigration Reform, a fellow named John Tanton, corresponded regularly with white supremacists, took money from an organization dedicated to eugenics. One can argue that we're wrong or whatever, but it's not the case that we're listing them simply because they want to restrict immigration policies or, you know, want to close the border. It's a deeper explanation than that.
So Heidi, your report for this year, which just came out a week or two ago, identified 917 hate groups in the United States. That was up from last year, a little lower than its height right after the 2008 election, but still at almost historic levels. So, and also, as I understand it, an increase of, 30% in anti-Muslim hate groups. So what are your findings? What does your data tell you about the state of hate in America today, 2017?
Well, the overall issue with hate groups is this. They've been on the rise since 1999, 2000. There's been almost a doubling in the number of these organizations over that time period. And so the growth of white supremacy and these extremist ideas is a reflection of a few things. One, there's no question it has to do with a backlash against changing demographics. And in 2000, that was when the census first announced that white people would be a minority in this country in the 2040s. I think it was 2042 at the time. That, of course, is a problem for you if you're a white supremacist, and it began organizing. It also caused a shift in the white supremacist movement from attacking black people, which is their traditional bread and butter, to attacking immigrants who were seen as more directly the demographic threat that they face, you know, Latinos. So the growth in those groups goes all the way through the Obama administration and all the way to today. So we have basically an incredible growth in the number of these organizations over the 16-year span that we've counted so far. In terms of this last year, it's a little bit different of a dynamic. You already pointed to the fact that anti-Muslim groups, you know, they went from basically 30 to 100, right? It was a huge jump.
It wasn't 30%, it was threefold.
Oh, wait, okay.
Threefold.
Yeah. My bad. Yeah. Tripled. Yeah, data errors by a professor. Who would have thought?
So this is a massive expansion of hatred here. There are various things that have sparked it. The refugee crisis gave groups that work in the anti-Muslim space something to react to and propelled a lot of very local organizing, actually. And we got a lot of organizations who, you know, are just rabidly anti-refugee, assigned to refugees, all kinds of crazy stuff. You know, they're here to rape your children, you know, they're going to commit terrorist acts, like, you know, those kinds of ideas. Also, we just saw that anti-Muslim organizations in general were, frankly, energized by the campaign and by terrorist attacks, right? The Paris attacks, the San Bernardino attacks, which add to xenophobia against this population, right? So that was the one thing. And Trump's, now President Trump's remarks about Muslims weren't helpful. And they sort of, you know, justified bigotry against this population. The other thing was that we saw it when you break the groups down, the other sector that saw growth were those organizations, you guys have probably heard this term alt-right, right? These organizations that are now branding themselves that way. Until like a year and a half ago, we just used to call them white nationalists or white supremacists, right? They engaged in a self-branding effort. Those groups, which were tightly tied to things like Breitbart and the campaign, made huge leaps in the number of chapters that they had. So the campaign energized those sectors of the movement. In particular, a group named Daily Stormer went from just a website, basically, a year ago, or maybe a year and a half ago, to the most widely read white supremacist site, surpassing Stormfront, the oldest and the largest in terms of audience up until that point, and also created... Now, I'm going to not have my statistics exactly right, maybe 35 or 40 real-world chapters in the course of that 12 months that we were counting. So those are the two things, the big things that happened in the last year.
Richard, your magazine that included the data for this year's report, its cover story, I think it said the mainstreaming of hate. So what does that mean, mainstreaming of hate? And Heidi mentioned this term alt-right. You know, what does that mean, and what are its manifestations in this current climate?
I'm going to need Heidi to help me with this. The Trump campaign, in many ways, because of some of the themes that he hit upon, the Muslim ban, you know, when he came down, you know, Trump Tower on the day he announced his campaign, and, you know, referred to, you know, kind of Mexicans as rapists. That kind of rhetoric energized the radical right. I'm not trying to cast aspersions on Mr. Trump, you know, as a person. I'm just commenting on, you know, what he said and what he did. One of the things we saw this time was typically, you know, the white supremacist sit out the campaign, right? Because they don't think there's a dime's worth of difference between the two parties. They think of both of them as irredeemably corrupt. This time, you know, they embraced Mr. Trump's candidacy. You know, Mr. Trump had some trouble because, you know, David Duke endorsed him. And he was asked, well, gosh, will you disavow David Duke? And at first it was like, well, I don't know who Mr. Duke is. And that, I don't know, but that seemed unlikely, you know? And there are many other white supremacists who, you know, endorsed Trump. Duke said, among other things, that one would be a traitor to his race if one didn't do that. The last time we saw anything at all, you know, close to that was in 1992, when Pat Buchanan ran for president in the Republican primaries. And his two issues, I don't know if some people would, and the students probably won't remember because they weren't here, but his two big issues were immigration and trade. Those were Buchanan's issues. But, you know, those issues maybe had greater salience now than they did then, and Trump is a better salesman than Pat Buchanan. And so we had these themes being energized. One of the things that one of my colleagues showed me, the person who coined the phrase alt-right, his name is Richard Spencer. Some of you may have heard of him. He's after the election, just a few blocks from the White House, there was an alt-right gathering, an event that Spencer hosted, and ended it with, you know, hail Trump, you know, and these Sieg Heiling. And at the Republican convention, he held a sign saying, want to talk to a racist, you know, inviting the press to talk to him. It was as if the label racism no longer carried any shame to it. So, you know, that's kind of part of the mainstreaming of it. You know, suddenly these ideas, you know, are okay to talk about in polite company. And, you know, again, and I should also lastly mention, you know, just Mr. Bannon. the CEO of both Mr. Trump's campaign, but also the Breitbart website, said that the Breitbart website was the platform for the alt-right. He was proud of that fact. Now, and the Breitbart website played down the racism, I would say, of the alt-right. Mr. Trump, during his campaign, linked to Breitbart more than he linked to any other website or any other news source. And now Mr. Bannon is kind of in the White House. And so, you know, the white supremacist, you know, I'm not saying they're correct to do this, but they're celebrating. They see their man as whispering in the president's ear. So, I mean, those are the factors, it seems to me, that have led to kind of the mainstreaming of hate, or, you know, kind of the normalization of hate.
So let's just get right to the point. Do you believe that alt-right is just a synonym for white supremacy?
Yeah, I do. I it's a rebranding. It's a smart rebranding. I got to give Spencer and some of the other people around him credit because, you know, and white supremacists have rebranded before. used to call themselves white supremacists. In the 1970s, they started to shift that term to white nationalist. Sounded less scary, basically. And this is a rebranding of that to take white out, right? To remove that term, which was the good indicator that this is not a right-wing politics, alternative right, but it is racial politics, right? So it, to me, it's just, you know, it's a rebranding of these same ideas for the digital age. And in fact, there's actually some levels of bigotry to it that might have not existed there before in terms of Muslims and other populations that are being attacked when, you know, white supremacy was really a black-white affair, white dominance over African Americans.
Can I add one thing to that? You know, there's a piece about the alt-right on the Breitbart website. It's a very, very long piece, co-authored by the incendiary Milo Yiannopoulos. And if you go to it, Yiannopoulos says that Richard Spencer, the person we're talking about, and a fellow named Jared Taylor have been accused of racism. It's an odd way to put it, because they would admit they're racist. They would say it. They would say, you know, black people are inferior. You know, Spencer is like in favor of peaceful ethnic cleansing. So they're accused of racism, makes it sound like there's some question about it. You could interview them and they would say they are.
Let me ask you about this question of violence by right-wing groups. So Congressman Sean Duffy, I'm sure you're familiar with the statement that he made. He kind of, and this goes back to some of your historic issue at the beginning, he said, you know, compared to terrorism inspired by Al-Qaeda and ISIS, it's much less dangerous. These are just, he said, these are just one-off incidents, whereas if you look at the San Bernardino and the Orlando shootings, they're backed by this international powerful organization. And I wonder, you know, with your familiarity of right-wing extremism, how would you respond to the congressman? Do the incidents when they occur, are they just one-offs, or they have support from an organization within that actually exists within America?
Well, I think Duffy's comments, in a way, are a reflection of the things that Richard was talking about, the history and the way that people think about white supremacist-inspired terrorism. Look, there's no doubt that this isn't like ISIS or Al-Qaeda manipulating, and I'm not even sure that's a totally fair description of how Islamic terrorist attacks work, right? But you do have outside organizations manipulating individuals or influencing individuals to undertake terrorist acts in various places. In the white supremacist world, there's no central power like that, but the ideas and the places where people learn ideas they motivate are actually just from a few places. Most of the white supremacist terrorist attacks that have happened recently involve people, for example, who were active on Stormfront, on the oldest and largest hate site in the world. In other words, Stormfront, in a way, is like a den of lone wolves. We know where they live, we know what they learn from, we know the ideas that motivate them. So I know that's not like ISIS, but it's not like there isn't a set of beliefs and ideas that have been motivating terrorism in this country around white supremacy forever. And for that, we can go all the way back to the Klan after the Civil War, right? The first domestic terrorist organization in the United States was set up on these principles, of course, more organized back then than what we see today. So I don't think we can call these one-offs. We know that terrorism in the United States consists of largely radical Islamist attacks, white supremacist attacks, and anti-government attacks. That's what it is. That's almost all of it. And of those, the number of plots actually tend more to the right wing. In fact, at one point we counted, I think under the Obama administration, up until maybe 2014, 2015, there was a right wing terrorist attack or plot every 34 days in the United States. Thank God most of them didn't come off. So this is a big deal. And there were far fewer that were inspired by ISIS or Al-Qaeda domestically here.
So I want to turn to questions from our audience soon, but Richard, I'd like to ask you a question. There's a lot of students here tonight, and it's great to see so many young people, so many students at this event. You know, obviously the last 3 months have been an eye-opener for a lot of people, especially those who haven't lived through some of the things that you and I have in our political history, and so And they really want to know, you know, what I get asked, okay, what can I do as a young person, a student, somebody, you know, trying to decide what my career might be, where the direction I want to head. The first advice I give them is, first of all, you know, keep your head down and don't forget why you're here, which is to get a first-class education, get your degree that you can then use for amazing purposes, because you can. It is easy to get so traumatized and caught up in the circumstances that you do lose sight of that. So that's the first thing I say. But beyond that, what would your advice be to somebody who's thinking about these issues?
Look, I don't think there's a simple answer to that. I think each of us in our own communities and our own spheres of influence have the ability to make change. And, you know, we were talking earlier, one of the most famous examples of that, you know, was 57 years ago this month, right? The kids in Greensboro, four kids who go and sit at a lunch counter, you know, they had no reason to believe that those actions were going to change the world. They just felt very strongly about it. And thousands and thousands of people followed in their footsteps. So, you know, I think people need to speak out. I think people need to go to town halls and ask their congresspersons questions. I think people need to write, you know, kind of letters to the editor. I think people need to be active on Twitter. I think the thing that is most dangerous for anyone to do is to be apathetic. You know, we know in this last election, Ms. Clinton got 64 million votes. Mr. Trump got 62 million votes. And 100 million people eligible to vote didn't go to the polls. So, I mean, I think the first thing to do is, you know, you need to study, but I think you also need to be politically active and not apathetic.
Heidi, did you want to add or that?
No, I mean, I agree with Richard. I'm always, the voting numbers alone are astounding to me, right? I don't know what would it have looked like if a big chunk of those voters had voted, right? What the outcomes would have been. But everything Richard says is right, and it's important to protest, too, if you feel strongly about something. It helps others see the way. And, you know, people forget sometimes that, like, the entire campaign against slavery, you know, in England when it began a very long time ago, was started by one person who slowly built something that over several decades ended up bringing down that edifice in England, and, you know, and eventually those ideas spread here as abolition. So you're right about the kids in Greensboro. It doesn't take much. It could just be one person.
And it's interesting you mentioned the protest, because you're so imbued in the civil rights movement in the South. And I was listening to Reverend Barber during the rally last weekend, and talking about the centrality of mass meetings to the movement and how it encouraged it gave people courage to do the things that they did, and it built solidarity. And it built the understanding that other people had their back. And that's incredibly important. And I guess the only thing I personally would add is that, you know, from my tradition, the notion of tikkun olam, acts of love and kindness. You know, there are a lot of people who are really afraid and hurting and have suffered trauma, fear that their family is going to be broken up. Last night in Chapel Hill, there was a very brave high school student who spoke at Richard's event, and it was incredibly moving. And she talked about how, you know, in her family, you know, they used to, you know, do fire drills or worry about, you know, what to do if the, you know, if some sort of crisis happened in their family. Now they have to think about, you know, deportation drills. Well, what happens if the authorities come to take my mother or my father away? And so I would just add to that, you know, patting someone on the back, asking them how they're doing, saying, hey, you know, I'm with you, things like that. I don't think we can underestimate, for people who are really feeling very vulnerable right now, how much that can make a difference. So with that,
I really want to get the viewpoints of and questions from folks in the audience. So please, ma'am, stand up and nice and loud because we don't have audio for you. So hopefully it'll be get picked up. I might rephrase your question, not because everybody hasn't heard you, but just so it makes it on the video. Thanks.
I just want to know how we should engage with people who support Trump who don't consider themselves racist or white supremacists, how to talk about the influence of white supremacy in presidencies.
So how to engage with voters who voted for Trump but really don't consider themselves or disassociate themselves with these notions of white supremacy? Yeah.
You know, that's an interesting question and a good question. I think that I was talking about this last night. I think Secretary Clinton made a terrible mistake when she used that term basket of deplorables to refer to Mr. Trump's voters. I think it was a mistake, first, because it wasn't politically very smart, but much more importantly, because it wasn't accurate. I don't know if you saw, there was this, I thought, very moving op-ed in the New York Times after that, that J.D. Vance wrote, and it's the person who wrote Hillbilly Elegy. And what he talked about was President Obama's grandmother. President Obama's grandmother was a white woman who raised him, sacrificed for him, and loved him. But sometimes all kinds of stuff came out of her mouth, the president tells us. Would we call her, President Obama's grandmother, part of the basket of deplorables? Obviously not, right? So I think that, you know, when one, you know, you may feel strongly about, you know, Mr. Trump in terms of, you know, the racist, misogynist, xenophobic things that he said during the campaign. But I think the first thing that's important is not to assume that those are the reasons why someone voted for them. And I think it's very important to talk about the common ground that you have with people, the values that you share, and not say to them, and that's why you shouldn't have supported Donald Trump, you know? That's not a starter, right? So you have to, kind of find the common values that you have, think about the problems that we face, and try to, you know, talk about the solution to those problems and the actions you're going to take based on those common values. Vilifying one's political opponents might work to get someone votes, but it's not going to work for us to be a better society.
You know, I think also one technique would be, you know, to explain to somebody how some of the things that he said or how some of his policies have affected you. So that way you're not talking about them, but, you know, if this person is your friend or respects you and you say, well, I need to tell you that what he said about this or this or this particular policy, this is how it's impacting me. And then, you know, let the rest sink in. You don't have to do anything more than that. Sir.
Thank you. This is more feedback than it is a question for the committee. And my feedback is this. As a long-time liberal Democrat contributor to ACLU and Southern Party, I'm dismayed by the apparent dismissal of what I see as the Islamic terrorist acts in America versus the white supremacists and the other hate groups. I say that because it seems like your organization is set up to chase after these groups. You identify them, you've done your homework, you know, much harder to deal with an event like the Boston bombing, or the San Bernardino, or the Fort Hood, or other instances in which indeed Islamic inspired terrorists harmed, killed, and maimed American citizens.
Okay.
This because I'm drifting away from the liberal democratic dogma. I'm becoming more conservative. God help me in my old age.
That's a very important question, so thank you.
Thank you for the question. And don't drift too far. You know, I have said repeatedly in testimony in Congress and in other places and here tonight that 9/11 was the, you know, Pearl Harbor of our time. I've never tried to minimize it. I've testified in Congress that efforts to focus on the body count after 9/11 misses the point entirely. The only point that I've tried to make, and I've tried to make it repeatedly, is that we can't ignore other forms of terrorism, because if we do, we'll let our guard down. So I can understand how our focusing on that could appear to some to minimize the threat of the kind of terrorism that you are most concerned with, and that I agree with you. I've said before in testimony in Congress that it's the preeminent threat of our time. I would never deny that. The question is, though, should we ignore other forms of terrorism? So I'm glad I had a chance to clarify that in response to your question.
Can I just add one small thing when it relates to this at SPLC? A lot of people don't know this, but we actually list, I'm not sure what the number is, maybe 8 to 10 organizations that are radical Islamic organizations. We list them as hate groups that are acting domestically in the United States. A lot of people don't realize this. Largely, we list them on the basis of anti-Semitism. So it's just a factual issue. It's not like they're exempt if they're domestic organizations from being listed.
Let me make one quick comment, which is, you know, in my research, what we try to do is place both of these threats in some sort of context. And that's not to minimize it, but, you know, I think you have to try to ask yourself, and the reason we did this is because we started out on some research projects, and the rhetoric, the discussion in the government about the pervasiveness of the numbers of people who believe in the Al-Qaeda and ISIS's ideology. And if you listen to some of the rhetoric, you know, it made it seem like there was a potential terrorist behind every corner. And so we tried to begin to put some numbers so we can compare it to other threats, other forms of violence. Not, again, it's not to minimize it, but how do you decide, for example, how much money it's worth spending to try to reduce the threat of Islamic terrorism by whatever you think is the right amount, 50%, 75%, or so on. If you don't know how many people actually in America actually find this ideology attractive. So one of the ways we did that is by, you know, trying to at least go to the point of the iceberg and the number of people who have been arrested or that we know traveled abroad to fight for these causes like ISIS, or the number of people who actually engaged in violent actions in this name. You know, and so... So what did we find? We found that since 9/11, the number of homicides in the United States attributable to Al-Qaeda and ISIS-related extremism accounted for 0.05% of all the homicides that took place during that period. That number would be higher if, as Richard suggests, you put in the 3,000 homicides on 9/11, but not much. Am I saying that therefore terrorism is a tiny problem? We should wrap up the FBI Counterterrorism Bureau and spend the money on something else? No, but I think it's worth pointing that out in trying to figure out, okay, how big a problem is this? That is why I do some of the things that I do, ma'am.
I wanted to ask the interlocutor a question that kind of relates to it. I know, David, that you did a survey of law enforcement officials, a nationwide survey, to get their sense of the threats that they were facing. I don't remember exactly the results, but perhaps.
Yeah, I don't have the data at the tip of my tongue either, but I asked them to rank from 1 to 5 within their jurisdiction. What did they see as the most prevalent threat?
And it was pretty significant results. Now, this was before ISIS, it was before San Bernardino and before Orlando, but ISIS was on the scene, and certainly Al-Qaeda, 9/11, Fort Hood, and all. And, you know, the large majority of the police departments rated the threat coming from anti-government and right-wing extremism as higher, they perceived, in their jurisdiction than from Al-Qaeda and ISIS-inspired events. That was from chiefs of police across all the large, medium, and small departments in the country. Pam.
Hi. So I guess my question is about the infiltration, corruption, and accountability of organizations that are government bodies by these types of groups that would leave a lot of vulnerable populations without any resources to get help. For example, if they do expand the border patrol official officer numbers, which I'm talking about on the news lately, I would be concerned that the kind of people who want those jobs might be more sympathetic to alt-right movements. And if they are the ones that have the authority and a broad span of to determine who gets picked up and who doesn't, then who's going to protect people without immigration status, right? And if you can just imagine, if they get to make that decision, then they could be in a position where, you know, they might extort very vulnerable populations. They might not call the police in times when they need to call the police, and they already don't do that. And I'm wondering, is anybody looking at these kind of organizations that might attract people?
So just for the video, the question was, how are we holding organizations with law enforcement authority or border immigration authority accountable to make sure they're not acting in a discriminatory fashion but in accordance with law? Is that a fair? That's your job, right, Richard?
I guess. Look, oversight is critical, right? Oversight is critical, and accountability, you know, kind of is key. One of the things that, you know, we have advocated against is, for example, white supremacists in uniform in the military. We've, you know, and I think over time made, you know, progress in that regard. We've advocated against an exposed white supremacists in police forces and gotten a number of, you know, kind of white supremacists fired as a result. I would never want to paint, you know, with a broad brush about kind of law enforcement officials or kind of the military. I think, you know, these are without question kind of fine people. But I also think even those fine people, you know, need to be accountable and, you know, need to be held to high standards. You know, one of the things that I think is somewhat counterintuitive, or at least most people think, is that, you know, the prevalence of police violence or the prevalence of police abuse doesn't seem to be correlated in any way with the diversity of police forces, right? The narrative is the white cop shooting the, you know, unarmed black suspect, but the prevalence of that of those kind of violence does not appear to be correlated with the diversity of police forces. An anecdotal example of that would again be something like what happened in Charlotte, right? So I think it's we need to be careful about making assumptions about people in that kind of context, and realize that, you know, all of them need to be accountable. I guess that's the best I can say.
Just to quickly add to that, you know, if you look at what happened with the first executive order on immigration, you know, I guess the bottom line is watch the courts and watch what the lawyers are doing, because
one of the problems with the way that was implemented was its very random enforcement by border agents that really didn't have much in the way of firm guidance or law to essentially, and what you were talking about, to guide their discretion. And the Great judges point. Looked at this and said, this is a country with the rule of law. This cannot be allowed. And there have been multiple injunctions against that executive order. Now we're going to see if there's going to be a recasting and whether it will be done in a different way that maybe is not going to necessarily be happy with it, but at least it is more fair and there's less discretion potential for abuse than what happened. So it doesn't take much in America to get before a judge, and the judges have power to enjoin the entire federal government from taking action. So watch the courts very carefully. Sir, please.
If I understand the criteria correctly for selection into your list of hate groups, and given statements by the President of the United States and his advisor, Steve Bannon, next year, can I expect to see the Trump White House on your list? And are you interested in the news cycles and attention that we
generate? The question is, does the White House qualify as a hate group under your current criteria, I believe?
You know, I would not go there. I would say there are petitions on change.org asking us to do just that. But I think that would be a mistake at multiple levels. But I understand your sentiment.
Let's get a student right here.
Yeah, so the Southern Poverty Law Center recently released a list of anti-Muslim extremists. And so I imagine that this was designed to highlight people guilty of sort of genuine anti-Muslim bigotry with sort of racist or xenophobic undertones. I was somewhat concerned about the inclusion of a couple figures on that list, Majid Nawaz and Ayan Hirsi Ali. So for those who don't know, Majid Nawaz is a current Muslim, Ayan Hirsi Ali is a former Muslim, raised Muslim. They simply just speak out against many liberal ideas coming from the Muslim world, whether it's female genital mutilation or, you know, terrorism generally. And so I'm just sort of concerned that this list sort of conflated people just speaking out against ideas coming from religion that really affects millions of Muslims detrimentally versus people who on the list, I'm sure, are genuinely, you know, anti-Muslim.
Thank you for that question.
Yeah, let me take that question. That is a criticism that supporters of Ali and Majid Nawaz have made repeatedly towards us. A couple things about what we produced, because there's been some confusion, I think, including coming out of Majid Nawaz's institute. That's not a list of extremists in terms of our hate group listing that we put out. What we put out was a guide for journalists of people that we don't think, and some of our allies don't think, are appropriate people to go on TV to discuss Islam. And so our point was to say, if you're going to have a discussion about Islam, you should take people who are fair about it. Let me just give you an example of Majid Nawaz's problem with him. He believes that all mosques should be surveilled. In other words, his opinion is that all Muslims are potential terrorists. That is problematic for us and is something that we don't think is fair if you're having a discussion about Muslims and terrorism. So that's one example. I'm happy to talk to you about it more at length, but that was the point of that. It wasn't to say all these people are members of hate groups. Some of them are that are on there, like Pamela Geller's group. It was to say, if you're gonna have discussions about Islam, Islamic terrorism in the media, let's at least get people who don't cast aspersions on the entire population. Fair people, conservative or liberal, that doesn't matter. But not people who decide that all Muslims are suspect.
Are you saying then that the idea that some people have that all Muslims are suspect should not be heard on the U.S. airwaves?
I don't think that's a fair discussion point to talk about these issues. I think that that is a truly extremist position that's not held up by the facts. I'd call it fake news, right? So,
sir.
I'll get you. I talked about the growth of these hate groups over the last few decades. I can't remember if it's a doubling or a tripling. One way that you could get that growth is for every existing hate group to just split into two or three, and then you end up with that many more hate groups. I don't think that's what you're saying. But can you talk at all about like the number of the growth of individuals in hate groups, or the growth and like the funding that they're being received?
Sure. So the counting of hate groups is, you know, a difficult thing to do. We don't have a lot of data out there to tell us exactly what the size of these movements are. People who are involved in hate groups don't really want to hand us their membership lists, right? So it's not easily accessible data. We have so we don't know the numbers of individuals involved, but we have some things we can point to. I think I already mentioned here earlier in a classroom that we know Stormfront has 300,000 registered users. That gives us a sense. If I were to take the four top forums of white supremacy and there would be overlap in membership, that's probably, you know, between 500,000 and 600,000 people. So we can look at those things as proxies, at least for the membership list. Funding for most of these organizations, frankly, is not a whole lot. They're run on shoestring operations. That doesn't mean every single one of them is that way. And the closer they get to power in Washington, you get people with major budgets. But most of them are run on almost anything. Now, the issue about the chapters is a fair point. There's sometimes situations, let's say we count a group with a headquarters and five chapters, and then there's infighting among that group, and it splits in half and it creates two organizations, each with five chapters. I'm exaggerating for effect. It would look like the number of hate groups in that case had doubled, right? And we do have that kind of splintering in the movement. It's not, I mean, we openly admit that this is one of the problems with our method, so it's not perfect. Also, another thing that's interesting about the list is about a third of the groups every year disappear and new ones show up. So there is a certain churn, right, to this list that's serious. And because I'm not tracking every single guy as he goes from place to place, it should be understand that those are some of the limitations of the list. So I hope that helps answer the questions.
I'm going to get to you after the question of the
student right behind. Hi. I just wanted to know about your opinions on the difference between policing hate speech and hate groups versus making sure that you're not infringing on like First Amendment rights and the right of freedom of speech. So there was the case at the University of Berkeley where a speaker was prevented from presenting and there were riots. And what is your opinion on that?
Well, thank you for the question. I think it's an important one.
I'm sorry. The question was, how about First Amendment rights on campus and the problems with blocking speakers who have certain views?
I'm sorry, ma'am. What did you say, or what? Yeah. Well, look, we're First Amendment folk. Even though we battle hate every day, we would never advocate for making hate speech illegal. You know, you have a right to say what you want in this country within certain bounds. You have a right to hate people. You have a right to be a racist. That's just the case under our Constitution. I think that, you know, if incendiary speakers come to campus, people have a right to protest them. I think it's a mistake to try to literally block their access and make it impossible for people to speak, such as happened in Berkeley, because I think it plays into the hands of those speakers. They get to portray themselves as martyrs. They get to say, aha, you know, you think my ideas are objectionable, but you leftist, want to censor me. You're the enemy of free speech, not me. And I think that was the narrative that came out after Annapolis was blocked at Berkeley. So I think it's a shame that lots of groups invite Annapolis to their campuses. It's been, I think, young Republican groups have invited him most. I think it's, you know, because he is an incendiary person. It's like thrilling to hear someone say this taboo stuff. Maybe it gives people a sense that, aha, you know, if he can say it, it's all right, right? And Annapolis is gay. So, and he's termed his tour the dangerous faggot tour, right? So if he can use language like that, maybe the fact that I'm using it is not so bad. So, I mean, I think that it's disgusting, but it's not illegal. And, you know, I think the people who invite him to campuses should be ashamed of themselves and should be shamed, but I don't think they should be harassed or blocked.
Yeah, let's understand that the marketplace of idea metaphor doesn't mean that just because somebody has been invited and does have a right to speak, that therefore they're immune from protests, or that the groups that brought them there should be immune from boycott, shaming, some sort of action. I think there is an effort to try to delegitimize those kinds of protests by saying they're censorship. That's actually not. That's the marketplace of ideas functioning in one way, shape, or form, so long as the person is protected and given the opportunity to speak in an open and fair forum. So I think that's an important distinction to make.
Sir, I see you nodding your head, but...
I'm shaking my head. I think you're wrong. That's not the marketplace of ideas. That's not... And legally, that wouldn't stand hardly any scrutiny.
Well, that's just not true at all. The right to protest against a speaker you don't like is an equal First Amendment right as the speaker to speak things that people don't like. You always have a right to protest. You just don't have the right to silence.
I don't understand, sir. I'd love for you, if you want to make your point.
No, I don't have any point. I wasn't going to say anything. I just was shaking my head because I don't agree with your view on free speech. I didn't agree with the lady's comment too on a list of people who are not, quotes, fair. That's contrary to the history of free speech. I mean, I you're a lawyer and I'm a lawyer. I can't think of how that would possibly pass muster in the Supreme Court.
Well, first, we're not telling news organizations what they can and can't do. Our point with that list was, if you want to put on someone who's going to talk about Islam, maybe you should choose someone else without such extreme views. If CNN decides to put one of these folk on, that's their right. But we're making a recommendation to them. We're a private group that advocates in that way, and we have a right to do that, and they have a right to ignore our advice.
As well they should. And okay. That's a method of prior restraint.
I appreciate your thoughts.
I did point to this gentleman here, and wanted to give him a chance. We're going to go for about 5 more minutes, and we're going to stop at 15:45. So those of you who want to stay until the end, we're going to wrap up soon.
Thank you very much for being this wonderful event. I have a comment and then a question. I think one of the important things that I keep bringing up as an American and as a Muslim, the gentleman already left, but as knowledge that is being constantly used to relate Islam to terrorism and Islam violence is very accurate. There are about 1.6 billion Muslims, and a very small minority are acting savagely and barbaric way. And this is documented that ISIS, the biggest victims of their savagery and barbarism are Muslims.
Yes.
So I think the terminology that's being used in politics, in the media, and the gentleman that left already, the individuals that are doing on their own account, whether they're being evoked by this propaganda by Al-Qaeda or all these terrorist organizations, majority Muslims are against terrorism, and we have an unprecedented level of events throughout the world denouncing, advocating against terrorism and violence. So I think the terminology really has to be changed.
Give us some advice. Tell us what.
Well, the question the question was, are we using improper terminology? I think the gentleman was referring to terms like Muslim terrorism or Islamic terrorism as a jargon for describing this phenomenon.
I think it should be used as terrorism. If we're calling it white supremacy, then we should call it brown supremacy, maybe, or some terminology. Because relating Islam, you're really using the language and the whole canvas and painting the whole religion for 1400 years of history, a very rich culture and heritage. I mean, that's not about you. I love it. It's SPLC, and I love the work you're doing too. I'm just talking about in terms of generally speaking. And that's what Trump is talking about, and he calls Islamic radical terrorism. I've been to four rallies and protested there, and the hatred is quite prevalent. It's quite scary. And I think that because it comes to this point where, as you know, last Thursday, the reports came out, FBI is probing this down, this group called Act for America in Kernersville, North Carolina, right, which is a quite extent group, and one of the members on the board is Michael Flynn, you know, said that we're going to go out and kill Muslims. So do you think that this should be called terrorist organization, and don't you think the FBI should go arrest them when they're making a direct threat to kill the religious population? Thank you very much.
Yeah, I think.
Oh, sorry. There was also a reference to an article in a triad. Well, they picked it up from a North Carolina publication about an open meeting or a meeting that was held at an open forum by a group called Act for America. And there were quoted in the story. One particular individual who made direct threats of violence said, "I've had enough of waiting. I actually want to take some action." And there was, you know, very directed, violent rhetoric.
He said because my only recommendation is to start killing the hell out of them, quote unquote, about Muslims.
Yeah. So, you know, my view on this is it's scary, right? Those comments are very extreme. I think that what has happened so far in this case is the right thing, meaning the FBI apparently is looking into this, and that's really what needs to happen, right? This is a law enforcement situation where there needs to be an investigation to see if this is a serious threat, right? Or if it's someone screaming and yelling. I do think there has been a tendency in the country to have those similar comments from the kinds of people we track at the Southern Poverty Law Center taken less seriously than from Muslims. I do think that there has been that history since 9/11. So at this point, I think what's happening is the right thing, which is there's an investigation going on. And, you know, we worry that when you get this rising anti-Muslim furor, that this is what happens. And, you know, if you look at what has gone on in the last year in terms of hate crimes, we could just look at the Quebec mosque attack from a few weeks ago. The Muslim community has been victimized at very high levels by a rash of hate crimes that have occurred. You know, mosques set on fire, people beaten up, and so, you know, that kind of violence is serious. The FBI needs to take it seriously. Department of Justice needs to take it seriously. And we can't have vulnerable populations exposed to this kind of stuff.
In terms of the rhetoric, you've never heard the term Islamic terrorism come off of my lips. The 9/11 Commission report did discuss Islamist terrorism. I know that's a distinction that falls on deaf ears. Often, they are Islamists. They do believe in a form of, you know, Islamic governance to the extent they believe in governance at all. So that's accurate, but I try not to use that either. I try to use the terms, I say, you know, terrorism or violence inspired by Al-Qaeda and ISIS, or the Al-Qaeda-ISIS ideology, which is what I think the most accurate way to describe it is. Okay, I think this will be our final question. Sir.
Yes, David Brooks had a very good column today in the Times where he talked about all the problems that come with weak economic growth. Do you see any correlation between economic growth and either the increase of or decrease of hate groups?
Yeah, I think that economic problems are sort of at the highest level a massive contributing factor to these problems. If you go back in history, like into the 1970s when the first anti-government movement rose, I think Richard might have said earlier something about the era of high inflation, the farm crisis across the West at the time. That was the rise of the Posse Comitatus and the earliest anti-government strains, militia movement type things. And there is a pattern where economic crisis correlates to an increase in extremism. And I think that we would be naive to think that this last economic crisis, which of course was worldwide, right? I mean, this is not about the United States, isn't a serious contributing factor to the rise of right-wing populism, both in the United States and Europe and other places. So yes. Now, how exactly the correlation between economics and extremism plays out is a contentious topic in research on populism, but it's clear that this plays a serious role.
Well, thank you so much. I wanted to say one word that, you know, we all come and we enjoy these events, and I enjoy being able to bring people like Richard and Heidi here, but it doesn't happen without the dedicated work of our staff here at the Sanford School, and I want to thank Katie Fanning, who has put together not just today's event, but a series of events all day long. And it's her first event, and she did a fantastic job. And Mary Lindsley here at the Sanford School does our events. And thank you for Emily Tothrow for arranging all the audio, video. You're all able to hear, I hope. And my final word, when I say, you know, I have a small token of appreciation, it is truly a small token of appreciation. But to both of our guests, I know you come from Alabama, but, you know, when you fill out your brackets in a couple weeks, don't forget where you've just been. Duke is going to do great. So with that, let's thank our guests.